I would like to start by asking the question, why retirement fund member education? We have so much information. Where are we? Sorry. Okay. We'll go through connecting the dots, having a look at the question of learning, providing education. I'd like to talk about the frame of reference, some reference to the process of questioning, and then I have a few questions which people have asked over the years, which I thought might, I don't know if it entertain you, but certainly I hope it would interest you. So, we start with why. And I think it's a very appropriate quote. And I'd like to just say that most people, including probably all of you in pension and the allied financial services, agree that member education is a good thing, with a capital G-O-O-D. The question I want to ask then is, why is so little of it actually happening? Because if retirement members don't understand how to prepare properly for retirement, how can they have a decent one? They need to learn how to get it right. Help is available, but we always seem to forget that individuals are responsible for the adequacy of their own retirement provision. Sorry, I'm learning how to deal with the way they've set it up. I thought this was an interesting comment, and I'd like to move to Albert Einstein, who, as you know, is quoted on almost absolutely everything that ever happens anywhere, anytime, anyhow. But he reckoned that information is not knowledge. And fund members have got a terrific supply of information, most of them. Jargon, of course, is a bit of a problem. But the question is, how do people turn this information into enough knowledge to create a better retirement? And there's so much more to this teaching than there is to reciting a list of facts. And these, and by the way, as Stephen put it, these are my opinion, my personal opinions, but I believe that education must teach members how to use, for example, their investment information to achieve the best retirement possible. Surveys show us that less than 50% of fund members ever see a financial advisor, refer to John Oliver on that, before they reach retirement age. So how are they being helped? And leaving aside views on financial advice, which I think we've had enough of for me to steer away from, how are people supposed to get this right on their own if they are not taught? Remember, it is their problem. There is thus a strong argument for teaching fund members how to understand and oversee their own retirement preparation. To my way of thinking, and I am biased because this is my business, I think that a defined contribution retirement fund without member education is in fact incomplete. Most people believe that a pension or provident fund will be adequate to do the job by itself, but this is not always true. Retirement values can vary considerably depending on the levels of contribution and the investment returns. And we've seen quite a lot of this with the defined benefit, defined contribution fund conversions, where people have moved from a high contribution rate to a much lower one without really understanding what the implications are. And people need to understand the investment options that are available in case they need to supplement their retirement savings. An American commentator called Richard Glass wrote in 2000 that the process workers should utilize in determining their retirement income needs and funding requirements is essentially the same as that used by large defined benefit funds in determining their liabilities and contribution requirements. Unfortunately, the average worker is ill-prepared to take on this task. To make matters worse, he or she is unfamiliar with the magnitude of the problem and has actually got no idea that there is a problem until it is almost too late. The graph you see in front of you, and I hear this a lot, if you save 15% of your salary for 35 years, that'll give you financial freedom, right? You've all heard it. So I thought I'd model this. So I took a salary and I grew it by 6% a year, and the contributions grew with it, and I applied a 6% net return to one column and a 12 to the other. And if you look at that, you'll see that A 6% return meant that the person got somewhere around about 26% of their salary after 35 years, and the person who had earned 12% per annum net got about 84%. Now, that means that this sort of thing's got to be qualified, because if you're not looking at returns, if you're not looking at contributions, if you don't understand the difference between pensionable salary and taxable remuneration, these people are mainly just flying around in the dark and hoping that when they get to retirement, there will be enough. So, surely if we are to educate, we must do the job properly. And by properly, I want to say, does that mean using education as a means to advance a brand? Will training provided by institutions sufficiently emphasize the negative as well as the positive aspects of their own products? Because there are negative and positive aspects to everything. Now, I've been watching quite a lot of the nuanced so-called free education that is provided, and I notice that the only people, and you can see why, of course, who mention the issue of keeping costs down are the index houses. And on several occasions, I've heard the phrase, pay peanuts and you get monkeys, used by trainers when asked about the implications of costs. And my personal belief, and it is talking to my own book, I must say, in fairness, that member education really should be supplied by professional organizations that have no conflict of interest. We believe that if people or members are to make informed decisions, and I don't know how many of you remember that Letlong Carney versus Southern Life Staff Provident Fund, I think it was, in 1998, the adjudicator's decision, John Murphy said that trustees have an obligation to ensure that members can make informed decisions. So how are they going to make informed decisions if they don't have a frame of reference or a context, if you want, within which to plan? And any education that they receive should in fact challenge them to create a framework for themselves or a context for themselves. We try to make our sessions as provocative as possible, and we encourage members to pursue their studies and their work in their own time. Not easy, but it can be done. When we started with member education in 1992, we asked members what they wanted to learn about. We said, what have you come here for? What do you expect to go away with? And I've collected 230 different questions that they asked. And that's not total questions, that's just the ones that I can differentiate. And every now and again I get another one. The one I'm battling with at the moment is, how do you find a decent online retirement calculator? I thought that was quite a difficult one to answer. And we use all this material, all these questions, in developing and designing our material. The techniques that we use, and I imagine everybody who does this training does, include workshops, seminars. Never been quite sure of the difference there. Webinars, video presentations, and e-learning, all of which is fairly new, and we're all battling to try and figure out how to get people engaged, I think is the term. And then we also ask employees who've attended to give us feedback and write comments before they leave the room. And the most common feedback that we get still today is along the lines that if I had only attended this workshop 10 years ago, or this workshop should be compulsory for every employee who reaches the age of 40. So the awareness is there. And I thought to end, I'd like to just share a few of the questions that come up all the time with you. I tend to forget about the slides. I hope you can forgive that. I thought this was a nice quote. The first one was, where should I invest my money? I think that's fairly obvious, and I think it's been interesting listening to the first part. Can we learn about investment basics so that we can choose the right channel? Who can I trust to help me make decisions, make my decision? I've got a few more. And another quote, I thought this was a very powerful one. No man really becomes a fool until he stops asking questions. And I think we should say that, what is it? The masculine shall include the feminine here, ladies. I apologize, but that was the quote. This, I thought, was a very interesting one. Do we have to invest in a pension provided by administrators, advisors, when we retire? Interesting. My advisor says I have to invest in a living annuity when I retire. Is this true? And then I have a few more that I didn't put. They're not on the slides. What is an annuity? How does it work? Another revealing one. Am I allowed to have my own investments if I belong to a pension fund? You sort of wonder when you listen to that. The usual, what happens to my pension money if I die before I retire or after I retire? And my favorite question is, how much is enough for retirement? How do I retain my standard of living in retirement? And the last one here is, if I don't have enough money to live on when I retire, what do I do? Nice question. That's me. Thank you very much.